www.ca/computer.
Thank you, Doug. Now it's time to present Steve McCreary. Steve has 33 years of applications experience in the areas of data, communication, automation, and training. He has developed national and international training centers for GE, Multilink, Siemens, and Omron. He is a sales application engineer for data communication, automation, and networking products. He has extensive experience in the design and commissioning of control systems and communication. His current employment with Schweitzer Engineering Laboratories in Barrie. His position is integration application specialist to communications. He provides communications and automation applications engineering support to sales, consultants, utility, and industrial customers in addition to SEL's internal engineering service team. Please welcome everyone, Steve.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. This presentation is almost like a how it's made sort of presentation. What I did is I wrote all over the SEL slides additional notes because I was kind of turning everything into more of a training session than anything else. So this is more of a how it's done. But I'm going to give you a little bit of the background on some of the thoughts, ideas, and concepts with regards to SIP before I actually go into the into actually how we implement more practical implementations of cybersecurity for, I'll call it, industrial substations, both utility and industrial substations. So just a little bit of the background, and Doug touched on this. Basically, the United States government, after several very high-profile problems with the electric power utilities, went to FERC, which is the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and said to them, look, you've got to come up with a bunch of standards here so that this doesn't happen in the future. Better operating criteria. So they asked for an electrical reliability organization to be appointed to work and come up with standards for the utilities. And NERC, which is the North American Electrical Reliability Corporation, was already working both with Canadian and US utilities, but at that time it was really more of a volunteer organization trying to make power better, more reliable. And so they were appointed by FERC as basically the ERO, and then what happens is the utilities and this group work together to develop standards. And these standards are then submitted to basically FERC, and once they're approved by FERC in the US, they become federal law. And in Canada, what happens is it basically they fall under the provincial jurisdiction to be enforced. And so that's kind of the history that goes on there. And really, these are the regions. You can see that the NERC regions are both north and south of the border. Okay, that 49th parallel really doesn't exist for them. And this is the standards, as Doug was showing you earlier. And the areas that I'm really going to go into is a little bit on personnel, electronic security, perimeter, system security, and configuration management. And the reason you'll see in a short period of time as to why I focused on those areas, because we actually have products, real implementations, that address these areas to assist customers become compliant with these standards. But there's a lot of other areas, physical security, policies, recovery plans, and each one of those sections has documentation as to what they're looking for. And in fact, this is what just a general description of each of those sections. There'll be an introduction, and in the introduction there'll be a title for the standard, some background as to why they thought the standard, justification for the standard itself, and what's really important is requirements and measurements. And basically, what we're looking for here is compliance, evidence, and documentation. And a lot of the utilities in the States we're looking at this initially that someone's coming into my backyard, the government, and they're basically trying to push me around. And you start talking to those utilities, because in 2016, some of the regulations started coming to law and they started getting some fines. A lot of those utilities that actually went through that arduous process, at the end of it, a lot of those same people look back and say, you know what? A lot of it makes common sense. It's good practice. For example, we were talking earlier, Doug and I, how many of you would leave your laptop on a desk like this with a bunch of engineers, walk out of the room with no passwords on it? Could you imagine the software that would be on your system by the time you got back, say 5 minutes later? The whole point of the matter is a lot of these requirements just make sense. They're common sense, both at the physical layer, right down into the cybersecurity layer. And in addition to the requirements and measurements, there's the passions. But here in the compliance evidence, and that's really what happens at the end, they get audited. Typically, they'll have a consultant come in ahead of time. Maybe it'll be an auditor in another region that actually comes in and does some consulting with them to help them prepare for the audit, to make sure that they have things in place, okay, the right things in place. And then they'll come to manufacturers looking for certain technologies, and that's where we step up to the plate. One of the definitions that you hear of quite often is cyber assets. What are the cyber assets? And in the case of NERC SIP, what they're looking at is whether it's a high or medium impact system, there'll be increasing levels of security that are required. But basically what they're looking at is the assets themselves, the devices, I'll call them protective relays. Some of you, do you know what protective relays are? Some of you probably know very much what they are, and others are basically they're the electronic devices that are on your power systems that's actually doing the protective relay and the automation of the substation. It's very important devices, and that's what they're called, cyber assets, and this is the definition for them. Sometimes they say that the communications infrastructure is not considered a cyber asset, but in the case of what we're talking about earlier, high speed Goose messaging, peer-to-peer messaging, rather than having wires between devices for interlocking signals, they'll actually use something called Goose messaging, extremely fast messaging between devices. The switches, it's through Ethernet, so the switch is actually a part of that control system, so they're also covered. In-depth, defense in-depth security really means multiple layers of security. And what we're looking for here is confidentiality, integrity of the data, and the availability of the system. And depending on what layer you're at, certain parameters are more important than other parameters. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that as we go through here. So if we take a look at SIP 5, we're saying that all of your cyber assets should be inside an electronic security perimeter. Electronic security perimeter, if you can imagine that. It's the network devices network together, and there is only a certain way from the outside to get into those devices, and it's through, in this particular case, what we're advocating, at least three levels of communication security here, but there's some sort of access controls, maybe locks, something of that nature. Then the communications across electronic security perimeter, priority there is confidentiality and the integrity of the data. So let's go back to this model, this multi-layer model. The idea is that, again, that each layer basically overlaps the other layer and enhances each security. So down at the bottom layer, we're talking about the IEDs themselves, high-speed communication going between them, the focus and
availability.
And they have to have
so that layer is your trusted layer
between them. Come back to that. Devices need to be able to communicate back and forth to each other. So that's the most important focus right there. The second layer is really the data aggregation layer. This is where your RTUs gather data from the different electronic devices to feed it up to SCADA, things of that nature. Also to take control commands and send them down to the device themselves. The idea is that the second layer, you're actually filtering. Devices outside do not talk directly to the IDs themselves. They'll have to go through this intermediate layer. So it's filtering to ensure the availability at layer 3 for their machine-to-machine communications. Of course, integrity of data is most important for this particular layer, so there's also baselining, which we'll talk about in a few minutes, and how to detect changes to the settings. And then your access layer, The focus there is integrity and confidentiality of the information. It's not truly a private portion of the network because you're communicating to the outside world. So availability is the has the lowest priority.
Okay.
So that's the strategy or thought process there. And what is the outside world? It could be SCADA, engineering access, real-time control. Those sorts of things are communications from the outside world coming in to your electronic security perimeter. So what I'll do is I'll talk a little bit about how we secure the communication links between electronic security perimeters. Basically in SIP 5, R1.1, it's a table, SIP 5, all of the little side grass that's connected to a network via routable protocol shall reside within a defined electronic security perimeter. Now, some people have actually gone to the extent of not using routable protocols to get around this. It's an interim thing, because what's going to happen, obviously, this is going to be changed. You might as well do the right thing from the start, okay? Secure that communication link. And if it's going to be a serial link, you can actually get encryption for serial links. We sell the devices for that. But if it's for routable protocols, there's existing technology that's in place that banks have been using and insurance companies have been using for years. We may or may not have employed it in the past. In a substation, but this is one of the recommendations I'll get around to that in just a few moments. External route connectivity must be through identified electronic access points. In other words, some sort of gateway up here. It has to go through some sort of known point, okay? And having one or more methods of detecting or basically known or suspected malicious communications, both inbound and outbound communications. So this is a key point here. And we'll focus really on the gateway itself, some of the features that we need to have in that as we move forward. Multi-factor authentication for interactive remote access sessions utilizing encryption that terminates at the intermediate system, in other words, at the gateway. Devices themselves, though, these devices down here, do not need to have access controls. In fact, a lot of times, as Doug mentioned earlier, their passwords are very weak. Because a lot of these devices have been in business or in service for many, many years. We still actually, our company actually, we say we have a 10-year warranty. We're over 30 years old. All the devices out there in the system that are our devices are still under warranty. You know, if you run it over your car, we'll replace it for free. No questions asked. That's the way we work. A lot of you know Schweitzer Engineering. That's just the way we work. And that's why we've grown the way we have. But the key is a lot of those devices have very weak security, okay? And you need to enhance it. So the devices themselves, they don't have firewalls, but they're expecting firewalls. So how do you do that? What are the concerns? Well, with large data streams, when they're transmitted, they're broken down into smaller packets. And a lot of these packets are in clear text. And third parties, if they gain access to this data, they can potentially manipulate the data. How can this be done? Doug had mentioned that 10 years ago, typically you had to have a computer science degree, and you had to be a pretty strong in the programming area. Well, that's not true today. Wireshark. A lot of you have used Wireshark before, have at least heard the term. Wireshark, okay? It's a packet sniffer. They can take a look at the Ethernet packets that are going across the wire. And what you can do is you can take a standard switch and you can do something called port mirroring. Or you can use a hub, an older version of a switch. Hub isn't really a switch, but anyways, basically what happens is when data comes in one port, it goes out all other ports other than the port that it came in. And you can actually sniff or detect the data. You connect that up to your computer and you run Wireshark, and in the substation, the premier protocol that's used is what? DNP3. DNP3 is used in the vast majority of substations. Let's take a look at a DNP3 packet using Wireshark. So you start sniffing the packet, and look, you have your source and destination IP addresses right there. Someone in first year computer science already knows what to do. Denial of service attack right there, okay? But For the more sophisticated hacker, here's the data. The address information for the master or the client and the server. Now we're talking about the tools or the information available to the more sophisticated hacker, or to someone who just wants to do real damage real fast. If you just, there's a click on, if you go up one other frame, you can actually see the source and destination MAC addresses. Spoof a MAC, and what do? You cause havoc. Ethernet doesn't work. Why? Because within the network, you have to have, what, unique MAC addresses. Okay? Poison the MAC table. So that's the problem. Attacks require access to the path that's moving across the network. That's a key point. They have to have access to that data. If they can gain access to that data, they may compromise the data itself or do worse. So what are the recommendations? Well, segregate your network. Don't just have everything on one flat network. Many times I go into substations I've seen, they just have in one flat network. Put in some routers between different layers. Break it up, okay? Or access gateways in between, gateways between the different layers themselves. And then you put some rules as to what data can go back and forth between those layers. We'll see how we can do that a little bit later on. Use a cryptographic wrapper. Monitor. One of the things that came in when one of the thought processes was with cybersecurity is that it was a one-time thing. You know, the utilities just have to do this once and that's it. No, it's continuous monitoring. By the way, their IT departments have been doing this for years, okay, on the IT side. And a lot of these tools that we're using on this side to secure the substation are the same tools that the IT world has been using, and a lot of the same thought process and the same strategies that have been used. Formalized change control, stay on top of firmware updates. I think you've heard this already. It's not that we were synchronized, it's just this is the game here, this is what you're supposed to do. Basically, VPN tunnels. That allows encryption. It's based on prime numbers. ASC 256-bit encryption is the best in class. I don't think we typically have computers today that can break that type of cipher. So what we're doing here is we're suggesting that IPsec or VPN tunnels between the substations. Okay, so the gateway device, that access point should have VPN tunnel. Okay, and basically what happens with the VPN tunnel is does authentication, it ensures confidentiality and message integrity, puts like a fingerprint on each of the packets as it goes back and forward. It encrypts the data and it makes sure that the device at the other end through keys is the right device that it's supposed to be talking to. And how we characterize this is you've got a slide or a water slide. The hacker can see that there is data going between these two points, but they can't decipher what the data is. Okay? He has access to the data stream, but he can't decipher the data. Alright? So that's the idea there. So basically VPN tunneling, but cyber assets do not need to support firewalls, but you do need to have access controls within SIP. We talked about access controls. What do firewalls do? Well, they restrict the access. They prevent connections, bad connections, provide granular filtering rules, and provide access controls. Yes, sir?
The last one where it said the devices in that zone don't need to support firewalls. Do you mean support on board or
on board within the device itself? Okay. Within the device itself. They don't, because these devices were made 20, 30 years ago. Yeah. You'll see the same thing about passwords. They actually backed off they were asking at one point for basically complex passwords, uppercase, lowercase, minimum of 8 characters. I think you all know about this because every 3 months you have to change the password on your computer, and a lot of the times it doesn't meet the criteria, and you're thinking, oh my gosh, what do I come up with? Okay, because that's the uppercase, lowercase, some sort of special character, numbers, letters, all that sort of stuff. Well, back then they might have just a 5-character password or a numeric password, and a lot of times those at the utilities, otter, tail, does that mean anything to you? Those are the default passwords that SCL products come with. OtterTail was the first utility that bought protective relays from Schweitzer Engineering. So in their honor, all of our product, when it's released, it comes out with OtterTail. You'd be surprised, up until recently, I won't mention anything about Canadian substations at all, but in other countries and their substations, you might find that Otter Tail is still the passwords of those devices, or was the passwords within those devices. I don't want to spread rumors. Don't want to spread rumors, sorry? So, restricting access, preventing connections, provide granularity and filtering rules, and provide access controls. Those are some of the things that they do. So, air gap is one way of doing it, just don't connect it up. And that's what a lot of people thought at the beginning, but in reality, can you just not connect up your substation? I hope it's working, there's no smoke, okay, we're good. Just kind of drive by with a car, can't do that. So you have to have some sort of connectivity there. The network should be divided up, as we talked about, the three layers. Okay, division, divide it up. And you have some sort of access in between, a firewall in between. Layer 2 uses MAC addresses. MAC addresses need to be unique. We talked a little bit about this. If a hacker gets a chance to see those MAC addresses, and this is assuming that this person's on the network. You've got a VPN between the two networks. Somehow he's gained access to the network. So you actually have to control the traffic to ensure that he doesn't gain access and be able to see that data. So routers help filter and subnet the traffic using an access control lists. One particular broadcast domain can only talk to these devices on this other broadcast domain, the IP addresses, okay? Certain protocols. Access control list rules specify which hosts or which group of hosts can or cannot communicate. Layer 3 for routable protocols. Communications to and from specific services, TCP, UDP services. What services are allowed to exist? So, example, for DNP, does anyone know what port number DNP uses? Oh, yeah. 20,000. Okay, how about 80? A lot of people, what? 80, right? That port number, okay, for basically web pages. 21 is FTP. So, basically, beyond that, what you'd have to do is you have to go into deep packet inspection. And with deep packet inspection, what happens is they actually look at the payload itself, and they're basically looking for malware signatures or basically communication channels that are going across and commands that are going across through the actual packets themselves. So that's deep packet inspection. The problem with deep packet inspection is typically to get wire speed or high speed communications, you need very powerful server type devices to do that. When you get DPAC inspection in a small box, a standalone box, it tends to slow down a lot of the data. So, and somewhat limits the bandwidth. So typically what we do in order to get performance within the substation, acceptable performance, it's a balance. It's always like it's engineering. It's kind of the balance between the money you can spend, right? Okay, and the technology you can apply. So engineering is really an art. People say it's not an art, but it is. You know, you have to balance the budget with what you can do constantly. Because if you didn't have budgetary strings, could you imagine what you could build? Huh? Okay, but unfortunately there's budgets and you have to have certain performance. So typically the best practice to include in place, you know, different layers of firewall rules, access control lists, look at the types of communications that you have out there. So you might want to say, that only on certain ports allow communications. On the relays themselves, device themselves, you shut down now all the ports. All of our relays have been released, new firmware such that you can shut down all unused ports at the layer 1. Media access control layer here, you can actually decide on what MAC addresses can go through. Even on the switches, you can decide, okay, only this range of MAC addresses go through layer 3. What routable protocols and what devices can talk in those routable protocols. You might even switch from the commonly used port numbers to other port numbers, and you can do that, okay? And that reduces the attack surface, the probability of someone can get in there. Stateful firewalls, they can track the communication, the connection. What I'm trying to say here is basically, if you wanted to do access a particular website, a stateful firewall can see that from the inside of the security perimeter, we're initiating a communication to a known good website, and then it allows that communication, that two-way communication to occur. If an external site tries to come in, no, that particular communication cannot happen. Okay, the stateful firewall sets up rules as to the direction and how the communications can happen. Yes, sir?
Most of the equipment is the clients, right? I would assume they're mostly clients.
Inside the
substation?
No, they're mostly servers. They're mostly servers. At this layer, they're at the IED layer, they're mostly servers. Okay. The client would be at the second layer, that data aggregation layer. But he is a server to the outside world, so it would be a host DNP client coming in to the server, the RTU server. So let's just say in the top of that RTU server, that RTU device, he's a server to the outside world, but then he will be a client to the IEDs down below. And the IEDs have peer-to-peer communications, their peers, using something typically like Goose messaging or mirror bits to talk back and forth to each other. Okay? Good question, though. Good question.
Can I say that the button there,
yes,
corresponds to the process link or process bus?
Process bus, yes, okay. It's actually below that layer. Process bus, actually, I'm just going to scoot back to that slide. It's a good question you have, though. These devices we use, process bus would be down here with the sensors, the CTs and the PTs. Okay, it's a good question. Are you in power?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, so that would be down there, and then that would be the process bus, and then you'd have the station bus would be the bus that they would have the Goose messaging through. Okay, so there are layers even below this, but we all consider the sensors to be also at the most secure layer. Very good question, though. Very good question. Question?
So you mentioned the kind of protection at the different levels, like from the physical to the MAC level and so on, but you also mentioned about MAC spoofing and so on. So this list, I guess, you kind of recommend all of those VMs and not just one of those.
No, yes, absolutely, but at different layers, one becomes more important than the other, okay? At the highest level, really what you're looking at is confidentiality. You're at this particular level and integrity of the data because you're going to the outside world, but on this level here, once you're inside here, once you're past that, then it's very important that you have some security controls here. But if you're inside this particular, on this network, on the trusted network, someone's got inside the trusted network, it's hard for this box to do that. But the Department of Energy came to SEL to develop a new technology, and we're going to talk about that in a few moments, that actually looks at MAC at the switch level.
What?
Yes, after the firewall. It's new technology and I've played with it, it works and it's fast. We'll talk about it in just a moment, okay? But here, what's more important at this level is availability for the devices, because you're talking about high-speed communication. So you don't want to slow things down. From one device to the other device, you have to get the communications there in under 3 milliseconds, the lady left the room that I was looking towards, the Goose messaging, under 3 milliseconds, protection speed stuff. So you can't be doing a lot of processing on that data. Whereas up here at the access layer, do you think the operator 20 miles away is going to notice that you're off by a few milliseconds? Probably not. So different types of, or different integrity, confidentiality, and availability, they take on the focus depending on what level you're at. They're more important, let's just say, one versus the other.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So we talked about best practices. Stateful firewalls. So you're looking for a stateful firewall that remembers or has rules as to which way the communications can be established and how the extent of the communication zone and who's talking to who. So what I'm showing you here is that you need to have firewalling and VPN at the highest level for basically ESP to ESP. And these are just our products here. This is our little promo here. Is our products do this. They do VPN and firewalling, but there's other products that do VPN and firewalling. And so that doesn't necessarily make them special at this point in time. There are some things that are utility hardened, but there's some other features that are they're specifically designed for the substation environment, which we'll talk about. This new technology that I spoke of just a few moments ago that looked at the Mac, basically software-defined networks. Very advanced technology, and we're looking at its use within the substation. In fact, RSTP, because of the speeds of convergence in our RSTP, a lot of times it was frowned on by some companies, including our own, using that for process bus type applications, or at the IED level. They were looking at this type of technology because of there's no convergence time. And you set up rules. You can actually look at the Ethernet header, or what physical port it came in on, and make rules based on that. You can look at the layer 3. It's this IP address going to this IP address. But back here, what's layer 2? Only certain MAC addresses. Right there. Only certain MAC addresses can get through. And it's lightning fast, so you could use it for boost messaging. Right up to layer 4. So you can actually control even what protocols are going. So every switch, software-defined network, the equivalent switch forwarding device, it's not really a switch because the control plane's been removed from the forwarding plane. The forwarding plane is what's in the substation. The actual, you have a controller which just configures it. It doesn't necessarily have to be running, or it could be running for intrusion detection. But basically, at each and every one of those devices, you have the equivalent of extremely high-speed firewall. Now, in the basically in the computer world, when you sign into the network to go to a particular drive, you're not really going to that physical drive, are you? You have certain credentials to get onto your network, and you go to a proxy server. A proxy server, which based on who you are, allows you to gain certain access to certain areas. We use proxy services now within substations. You basically, when you sign in, you connect to your security gateway with your password. Your security gateway talks to your LDAP server or Radius server and allows you permission into the system. Why would you do that? Because under SIP 4.6, basically you have to have access revocation within 24 hours of someone leaving the company. Think about the number of substations and the number of devices that fellow might have touched and has access to with regards to the passwords. How are you going to go in there and change all those passwords on all those individual devices within 24 hours and also update everyone else as to what those passwords are? These are the requirements. So the only way that you can do that is the same way they do it in the office environment. Password revocation is done by doing it at a server. So within the substation, this device has an LDAP built into it, which can connect up to the server. If you lose communications, you can still log into this device. And then talk to your device down here. Your password is not the same password as the password that goes into the device. The password between this device, your gateway, and your relay can maybe just a 5-digit password, that's simple password. But you don't know what that password is. You just know your own local password, which could be a complex password. So we address the complexity and length, but also we have to change the passwords on a regular basis. Every 3 months, I mentioned, or 4 months, you have to change your password. Well, we can have automated password changing happening in the device itself, and you end up with a password list. So that this password is no longer static, it's revolving. Some utilities are actually implementing this now. They do make sure, however, that they get the password report, what it was and what it's going to be, because if this breaks halfway through the process, suddenly you don't have access to all of your money makers. So it's important to get that list of passwords.
Excuse me.
Yes.
One question. If the Bob is an attacker, mm-hmm. but he steals a credential, so how to identify the
perfect? The good question.
Bob with a legal credential.
Okay then. So when this is what was happened in getting around these facilities, typically it's human engineering. The question was, how do we detect that this person who has good credentials, that he's got into the system? That's your question, right?
Yes, yes.
How do we detect that? We can't prevent it because at that instant in time, he's got a key to get in. Okay. The key is that during the forensics, you have to have the information, and NERCSIP realizes that attacks will occur. You can't prevent attacks, but you need to have the forensics to know how they got in, okay, and to prevent it in the future. But there's more. You have a very good question, so it's almost like one of these movies or one of these, you know, sitcoms where, you know, someone gets shot or whatever, you have to wait to the next episode. So good question. We're going to come back to that question. I'm not going to ignore it. It's a very good question. Okay, but some of you who work for utilities say, hey, this is great, all this password stuff, but in the real world, things happen like ice storms, okay? We also get local events that happen, and we also get like tornadoes that come through, and at those moments in time, they're not so much worried about the hackers. They're worried about getting power to the people and getting power to the hospitals. That's kind of really important stuff at that point in time, or during fires. I think out west had some fires out there. So we need to get into the substations. Well, what you can do, and this is going beyond NERCSIP requirements, okay, is that you can actually, with some devices, our devices, you can do it. I don't know if there's other devices that can do it, to be honest with you. But what we can do is we can go to a default password. We can issue to the device. It's an emergency situation. We see a storm coming in. Go to a default password. And so the devices will go out there and start putting the default passwords across the entire network to all of the devices. And then once the storm goes by, okay, then you can send another command and it'll re-encrypt or put in, not re-encrypt, it'll actually put in a different, a complex password that people don't know. So that's very important to be able to do that, all right, which is not really something that's thought of a lot, but at the time of a natural disaster, you have to be able to get into the substation, people have to be able to get to the IDs, okay? So again, cybersecurity is a balance. There has to be access. I mean, you can't just lock everything down so that no one can use it. I mean, it's secure, but it's useless, right? So that's important. Let's go back to, how do you detect unauthorized changes? Someone's gone in there and done something to your system. That's a really hard issue. You have to do some baselining, okay, and you have to monitor your baselines on a regular basis. But maybe that's just not good enough. Okay? That's just not good enough because that's meeting the standard. We want to exceed the standard. So, first of all, when you're doing proxy services, particularly with our box, we can actually take a look at the commands that you're issuing. Who logged in when? And the commands that you're issuing, we have a record of that. And what was changed inside the IED, we have a record of that. Okay? So you can see who logged in when, and what activities they did. It's called activity reports. Also, you have syslog. People will be hacking, they'll be trying to gain entrance. You have syslog, you're reporting it out. How many times, I don't know how many times I've mentioned to people that there's syslog agents out there. These devices, the switches and the device themselves, they're reporting, someone's trying to get into the system. But if there's no one listening, right? So you have to have syslog, you have to have people actively looking at it, and actually there's software out there that looks at different patterns and can detect attacks, okay? You have to know that you're being attacked. a lot of these systems are so good that basically you're driving along, it's like you're driving along the road in your car and you got a flat tire and it swaps out the tire for you. It's giving you notice that, hey, I swapped, you're running on your spare tire, but no one's listening because they're not listening to their syslog. So that has to be monitored. Okay, syslog has to be implemented. But in addition to that, knowing what they changed, this would be, say, after a problem has occurred. What you can do is there's some devices out there. In our case, we use something called an RTAC, Real-Time Automation Controller. And basically what this device does is it looks at the setting files. It issues a command, and it looks at the settings. You can specify to do it once an hour, once every 15 minutes. It issues a command, and the response back is basically a text file of all the settings in the device. And it calculates a checksum, and it stores it. And guess what it does an hour later? It does the same thing again. So it's constantly monitoring the actual setting files. And when it sees that the two don't match, it issues an alarm. It says, hey, setting files have changed. And you can get that. We do it in all of our RTACs, and a lot of you have those from the utilities, you have them in your substations. I was mentioning it yesterday, I was in Kansas City. A fellow had been working with the RTACs for years, he's got them in all of his substations, and he was asking me, how do I detect when there's some sort of setting change? Well, that's a basic feature of the RTAC. Okay? When the settings in the relay have changed, it actually alarms you. Now, you got to connect it up to something, you got to be looking for it, but it's there. Alright? So, VPN, firewalling, use proxy services, LDAP radius, automated password management, emergency passwords, security audits, syslog. Did that answer your question earlier about the RTAC? It's monitoring the setting file. So you get the audit report, you know whose password was compromised, and as soon as there's a change made to the device, you get notification that there's a change to the device. So that's how these are our solutions for specific areas of SIP. But there's now at least 13 sections and growing of SIP, and I think we address four or five sections. You can see why, because they're the actual devices themselves, the protection network itself, but phishing attacks on people and things of that nature, all those other aspects of cybersecurity, it's a holistic approach, it's a layered approach. It's not only devices themselves, it's the people, it's the storing of the documentation, it's all those levels. And by the way, SIP documents, it's the SIP standards, both the US and Canada contributed to them, and you know what they use as their number one reference? The NIST standards. And so does the Department of Defense in the US. The NIST standards are very good standards, so if you want to understand where the SIP standards are going, take a look at the NIST standards. The NIST standards are the future, okay, of the SIP standards. So anyways, that's what I had to say. It's very practical, it's not high level, it's more of a, as I said, how it's made, this is what we're doing today. Hopefully it's helped you out a little bit, answered a few questions. So, yes sir.
So you mentioned earlier that in terms of if there is a natural disaster or something like that, mm-hmm. the system goes to default settings. But for the user,
if you command it to.
Okay. So in that situation, what level of communication do you allow to the user?
Okay. The user would have to know what that default password is. So again, it's a larger circle of people that know that password. It's a pre-programmed password. So just before that natural disaster, that password is basically known to a group of people, so you're not as secure, but it's typically the people within your region, okay, that know about it, but it's not an individual password, so you have some levels of password security. Again, after the disaster or the danger has gone away, you initiate another command and then it changes the password. So for that brief window of time, you've decided that, you know, again, like everything else, you have to weigh, is security more important than availability of the system? If we lose communication, we have a wide area disaster. I think availability to get in there and make changes is more important at that point. But then you go back to a secure posture later on. And there's two more questions.
Sometimes maybe the attacker only log into the system with a credential, and he does nothing, only look into the system.
That's right.
To,
that's the most sophisticated hacker. Very good question. The most sophisticated hacker looks and probes for a very long time and does nothing. But what you notice is that sophisticated hacker is supposed to be Bob, and Bob's on vacation this week, but yet Bob's logged into the network this week. So that's why the syslog is very important, the syslog, and monitoring of the syslog. Who's logging into the network at what times? Does it make sense that these people should be logging in at this time? You might want to go back to those people and ask those people, are you, why are you logging? Also, what are those people supposed to be doing that we, sorry?
You mean that double check.
Double check with the people,
the
yes.
Logs.
Right, you double check with them, and also passwords. You're asking, why do they make me change my passwords regularly? Because your password could have been compromised. It could. You might have it on the front of your terminal, my password is, or you might have mentioned it to your wife or to a friend to get in, or whatever, or they've somehow guessed your password, so you have to change it regularly. That's why they do that. Phishing attacks, things of that nature. So passwords do get compromised, and for short periods of time, people do get into the system. But it's your secondary, your syslog, things of that nature, people have to be monitoring that. Or, yeah, you don't know that someone's in there. Or people say, yeah, we won't make everyone change your password every, we'll make it every 6 months instead of every 3 months. Okay? Not a good idea. Not a good idea. Yes, sir?
How different would all this be for another industry, for example, let's say chemical plants?
How would it be different? It's a good question that I'm asking you.
I'm guessing not much. Because
these are actually industrial. I took off the name industrial substations, but in reality, does this not make common sense that you do this? Would you have one flat LAN in your entire chemical plant so that one person can just do a denial of service attack and suddenly your whole network's down? No, that's why you split up your network and you put in access controls. It makes sense. It just makes sense. Now, going to the level of software-defined networking, we're just releasing the technology. I mean, it's pretty sophisticated LAN technology. It's extremely robust, very fast. We think this is the technology that's going to take over the future. Some sophisticated users like Google are using this type of technology where you see, oh, suddenly there's a demand for a certain website, so they can dynamically do some traffic shaping to the system. But in our case, being able to secure the network makes sense. To be able to secure a chemical plant network makes sense. If there was a hole once when there was a plant, it's kind of an important thing too, right? Right. Very good question. Very good point. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was just wondering how you see the system evolving in the next maybe 5, 10, 20 years. So there's all this legacy equipment, which hopefully will go away at some point, not very soon. But how do you see this? So the attacks will get more sophisticated, but hopefully the system will be designed with security built in from the beginning, which wasn't.
Yes, it's like a chess game.
So, but do you see that this will become easier 20 years from now when everybody will be thinking about it, or even harder because the hackers will be even more sophisticated?
I think a lot of the exploits that have been done up until now have been opportunity. Weak security practices. I think it'll get more difficult because even today, the way they got into a lot of these facilities, you talked about dropping off the USB keys, right? Because they're using standard protocols, so they had to get someone to stick that USB key into the network and for it to then go start looking for the controllers, right? Or when they guessed some passwords in the Ukraine attack and they were probing actually for a while, they were looking around. They didn't actually attack right away. They were looking around to find the best way, and then there was a decision made to execute the attack, okay? But I think as we train people to become more security aware, I think that that will make it much more difficult. But the attack, the hackers will get better, but then we'll have young, bright engineers on the other side defending it. But it's a war. It's a war, and it's going to get more sophisticated. The weaponry is going to get better all the time, and there will be an escalation in it. But you know, you have to be, number one, you have to be aware that it's there, and you have to be taking action. Right now, to be honest with you, up until the last few years, it seems like a lot of people weren't doing a lot. A lot of the utilities are, a lot of good people are doing a lot of hard work coming up with standards for themselves. And they're looking at the NIST standards, and they're working, and they're securing their networks. But it's just like any other industry, you know, rules are only made when after, you know, disasters have happened. We don't tend to be very proactive. But yeah, it's going to get more sophisticated. I'd love to be able to have a crystal ball, but the security today for the substation or the industrial plant, I mean, compared to what it was, basically almost non-existent in the past.